shining in buildings and guiding us through the shining times. Blessings on you as we gather for worship. 25 of our St. Paul's people are at Coyote Lake Lodge this morning. They are worshiping with the same scripture passage that is drawing us together this morning, and they know that we are holding them in prayer and they will be praying for us. And so I would like to open worship this morning with the blessing that I wrote for them. So to imagine hearing this in Coyote Lake Lodge, where there is no ambient traffic noise. Over the course of the night, you have not been wakened up by the light from the street post outside, and you are surrounded by a number of friends to whom you have drawn closer in this time, as they are imagining us hearing this prayer in our warm and affirming place of worship. In God's grace, may blessings fall upon you like sweet snow, blurring your eyelids with beauty, melting in cool drops upon your tired eyes. May joy stay with you, like holy songs sung with friends, bringing to mind safe and easy times. May love shine in your life, like bright February afternoons, certainty of the light of life, and that you matter. May friendship hold you steady, and may the peace of Christ fill your soul. Amen. By the Lord of sea and sky, it's 509. We're singing verse 1. 509 in the beginning voice tonight. Understanding of physics and light bring us to see more clearly what is above us, and we pause to praise, to wonder, to learn of the glory that is around us, above us, and within us. The friendships we share are full of your grace, understandings of shared experience, laughter, meals, rainbow pancakes, change, forgiveness, figuring things out. We bring to you this morning our awe and our desire to figure things out. Whether it's the beauty of the stars or the complexity of our lives together. For we are grateful for one another, for the legacy and presence of people we understand and those with whom we share this world, this country, and this city, with whom we have differences of experience or heritage. We ask your blessing because we try hard, and sometimes we are tempted to give up, and then we try again. We ask your blessing on the people who are pulled apart by issues of pipeline and rail, by issues of being hereditary chiefs and elders for the Wet'suwet'en, and for those who stand with them and are wondering their way forward. We acknowledge that we are all part of one another's lives, in awe and in figuring things out. And we ask for the presence of your grace, so we may be constructive, faithful partners in all that we do. And this we pray in the name of Jesus, who called us not because the life of faith is easy, but because it is loving. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever and ever. Amen. I have called you by your names in 161, in More Voices, 161 in the Choral Loud Book.
God, creator and provider, water, an ordinary thing of life, in this time and in this action, points beyond itself to you and your love, teaching us to be alert to the sacred in the midst of life. It flows in rivers that carve character in our cities, oceans that breathe the world, rain that nourishes. Our ancestors in faith remind us that your love nurtures, sustains, and transforms us even more than water. We ask for your grace to carry this child and put peace into her hands. Amen.
What is the name of your child?
Kalani Matthias.
Deandra and Alicia, drawn by God's grace. To trust in God who has created and is creating, was come in Jesus, the Word made flesh, to reconcile and make you, and who works in us and others by the Holy Spirit.
We do.
And drawn by God's grace, will you make your home a Christian one? Nurturing your child in faithful love and peace, open to a growing understanding of God and God's presence in your lives.
Drawn by God's grace, will you see that Kalani has a Christian community where she can participate in the sacred in the midst of life, joining with this congregation to share in the life, work, and ministry of Jesus Christ, participating in the sacred in the midst of life.
We will, in God's love.
I ask members of the congregation and friends who are willing to take this vow to please rise. Drawn by God's grace, do you commit yourselves to this child, Kalani, and to her parents, Deandra and Alicia, to pray for and support them as they live into their Christian faith?
We will, in the peace of Christ.
You may be seated. Kalani, Natalia, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit, one God, Mother of us all. In honor of nurturing Kalani and her mothers, teaching her what we know of the goodness of God, sharing what she knows in return. You know this, and it thrills me. Thank you. You represent all of the congregations. May God of peace be your peace. You will find it in your hymn books at 222 in the Qualifier Room. May God of peace be your peace.
Amen.
At number 71, you'll find the window winter blows. 71 even grown out. God, we are an earth-bound people. We welcome the return of the light, the gentle feeling of warmth on our faces as we walk in our neighborhoods, the extended daytime through supper, before breakfast. And we are an earth-bound people. Sometimes we distrust the dreamers who tell us they have seen a new and good land, a world united in peace, justice flowing like a mighty river, creation healed and renewed. But we know the way things are. We know ourselves. For every silver cloud, there seems a dark lining. For every glorious winter afternoon, there is a bitter morning in February. For every tender offering of compassion, every small seed reaching out, there seems a stubborn weed of hate. Open our eyes to see your glory, even in places and people we might write off as lost, even in ourselves. Forgive our hard-headedness and our hard-heartedness. Call us your own beloved children. Give us grace to believe that we are. Call us back to the glory of the mountain, the sparkling of the snow, the sacredness of the light. Remind us that we are love in your name, and that we bring love in the name of Jesus. When Jesus' friends were overcome by awe and by fear, he touched them. He said, "Get up and do not be afraid." We have a Compline at Christ's own bidding. It's 135 in Voices United. In this gorgeous old English tune, the Abbot's Lane, 135, the voice is limited. Oh, sorry. I'm really low. 104. Thank you. 104.
And his brother John, and he led them up a high mountain by themselves. And he was transfigured before them. His face shone like the sun. His clothes became dazzling white. Suddenly there appeared to them Moses and Elijah talking with him. Then Peter said to Jesus, Lord, it is good for us to be here. If you wish, I will make three dwellings here, one for you, one for Moses, and one for Elijah. While he was still speaking, suddenly a bright cloud overshadowed them, and from the cloud a voice said, This is my son, the beloved. With him I am well pleased. Listen to him. When the disciples heard this, they fell to the ground and were overcome by fear. But Jesus came and touched them, saying, Get up and do not be afraid. And when they looked up, they saw no one except Jesus himself alone. As they were coming down the mountain, Jesus ordered them, Tell no one about the vision until after the Son of Man has been raised from the dead.
Now, we'll sing 135, but it's in the other book.
Oh,
I'm told by my family to stop using emojis. Not because I'm tempted to throw them into academic papers, although I will tell you, I was reading an academic paper for a student this week, and right in the middle of the paper is a little yellow smiley face. I ask you, is that a good idea? Some of you are in a good spot and have an opinion on that. Thank you very much. But I've discovered that I don't always use them accurately. There's an emoji that I love. I can do it in women with 5 different skin tones and 5 different colors of hair. And I was certain it was a big hug. And I was putting it in my emojis to my family. This woman with this colored hair and a large hug. And I sent it to my brother, and I sent it to my sister, and I sent it to my daughter, and I sent it to my niece, and I sent it to my nephew. It was only my daughter who had the perspicacity say to me, "Mom, stop." "What do you think that means?" I said, "I'm sending you hugs. I love you so much." She said, "Mom, you know a little bit about looking things up. Look it up." I looked it up. What it means actually is go away now. And it's very, very rude. All right. So I am retaining my list of emojis. That same person, my loving daughter, who gave me permission to talk about her, because the deal is that if I speak about her when I don't have her permission, I have to buy her ice cream. I have permission to speak about her. She also said, "Mom, your use of Bitmoji is excellent." Now, Bitmoji is a social media app where you go in and make all kinds of designs about yourself. First, you design your fashion, your hair, your glasses, your shoes. And then the lovely people in the internet send you pieces all the time of yourself bursting out of an Easter egg to say Happy Easter, or coming down a chimney to say Merry Christmas, or simply with something that says Good morning, or will you join me for coffee? So that one apparently I do just fine. No more emojis, lots of bit emoji. I don't do a lot of Twitter, but I do like the hashtag. And to take a little phrase and put a small hashtag, which is the number sign, when you come into our church and you use a code that Anna gives you so that you can come in for choir practice or to prepare things for Garland Food Security or for a property committee meeting, you have a 4-digit code, and then you have the small number sign, also called a hashtag. It is actually the hashtag button that makes the click that opens the door. Those of us who are using codes use a hashtag every day to get into this building. Many of us on social media use that number sign, the little hashtag, and if you're wondering what it is, it's in the sermon title. That little number sign looks like sort of a truncated H. Hashtag will bring together a few words to draw them to people's attention. And then if you put that particular phrase, say, Thursdays in Black, the hashtag in the front, hashtag Thursdays in Black, immediately on your internet browser, you come up with all kinds of places where people are doing that exact thing, putting up hashtag Thursdays in Black. Thursdays in Black is a movement against violence against women. There are people around the world, Christians and others, who dress in black on Thursdays as a way of reminding us that we've got a long way to go to ensure that women and girls are safe. So hashtag Thursdays in Black is one way into it. There are many others. Hashtag TBT is Throwback Thursdays. Hashtag Monday Motivation. Perhaps some of you need a little motivation on Mondays and do hashtag Monday Motivation. There are all kinds of them. And it's sort of an inner language that one can understand. It's a way of bringing attention to something. It's a way of drawing people into a common activity. It's a way of bringing people into a community where others are concerned about the issues that confront us. Sermon title today is hashtag. Hashtag because this Wednesday coming is Ash Wednesday. Some of you are going to be on Jasper Avenue, and someone in a collar similar to mine, perhaps, is going to meet you on the corner as you're waiting for the street light and say, "Would you care for an imposition of ashes?" And you may be slightly surprised. And you may say, "No, thank you," and scurry away. Or you may say, "Yes, please," out of curiosity. Or you may say, "Yes, please," because you know exactly what it means. And that person then will bring out a small vial of ashes from last year's Palm Sunday, that had been melded together with a little bit of oil that will not burn your skin. Then on your forehead will be imposed a small light cross. Some Protestants are out there and just put forward our hand. If you would like to come to the Labyrinth Walk on Thursday evening, you have the option of receiving an imposition of ashes. And the phrase that goes with the imposition of ashes is, "From dust you have come, and from dust you shall return. From dust you have come, and from dust you shall return." Biblical words. Strong words about humility, about the brevity of human life. This is all done in a religious setting, religious sanctity, the holiness of God's world. It's not about you dying, it's the end. It's about acknowledge your mortality. You are a child of God, beloved. And you acknowledge your mortality. Some of you will be on campus and you will find persons offering you imposition of ashes. It draws attention to the Christian faith, to the acts of repentance that we are about week by week in our faithful lives, and to the season of Lent, which is beginning. How do we choose to draw attention to our faith? How do we choose to show our faith? The closest friends of Jesus were with him on the mountaintop. The mountaintop brings to mind that Moses was on a mountaintop when he received the Ten Commandments. It brings to mind that there will be another mount called Golgotha that will receive the breathing Jesus and release the Christ about to rise. James and John and Peter get to have solitude, quiet time with this dear friend and this astounding encounter. Shadow comes over the mountain, like a cloud. And a voice from the cloud says, "This is my beloved Son, with whom I am well pleased. Listen to him." And Peter, the rock on whom the Church of Christ is founded, is so taken up with awe that he says, "Let me build three shrines. Because behind Jesus is Moses, the great leader, and Elijah, the great prophet. Let me make three shrines. One for you, Jesus, one for Moses, the great leader, one for Elijah, the great prophet." But Jesus instead takes them back down the mountain. He has been transfigured in shining light. He has been transfigured before his three key leaders. And in the presence of the key leaders of the past, he has been transfigured. He has been shown to the Son of God.
was a wave of thoughts in Peter's mind of staying there with the shrines, of having a Karen to come back to, of enclosing the awe-inspiring experience and leads them back down the mountain. And back to the people. As we sing, in that gorgeous hymn words by Carl Daw, the one that I got in the number room, courage to proclaim what we profess, that our daily lives may prove us the people of God we bless. We go back down the mountain, and curiously, Jesus also says to them, say nothing of this until I rise from the dead. Keep it behind your teeth. Remember it, but do not proclaim it. With present while we are working among the people on God's good earth. How do we show our faith? Our daily lives may prove us people of the God we bless. Our daily lives, beyond the experiences of light and cloud, our daily lives. Our gathering to decide to become the affirming congregation. For persons who are lesbian and gay and bisexual and transgender and bisexual are celebrated. Welcome, celebrated, fully a part of who we are and how we move. In our daily lives, as we work our way through truth and reconciliation and what it means to be truly neighbors and to love our neighbors as ourselves. In our daily lives, as we listen to the teaching of Jesus, love your enemies, and figure out how to make our way through a world that is increasingly divided. And we take leadership from the ones of the past, Moses and Elijah and the other prophets. Martin Luther King Jr. once said, well, I don't know what will happen now. We've got some difficult days ahead. But it doesn't matter with me now, because I've been to the mountaintop, and I don't mind. Like anybody, I would like to live a long life. Longevity has its place. But I'm not concerned about that now. I just want to do God's will. And God's allowed me to go up to the mountain and have looked over. And I've seen the promised land. I may not get there with you. But I want you to know tonight that we as a people will get to the promised land. And I'm happy tonight. I'm not worried about anything. I'm not fearing any man. My eyes have seen the glory, the coming of the Lord.
There are ties between us, oh.
Time for minute messages. Some of you have announcements that the rest of us need to hear, and here's the microphone.
Good morning, my name is Lori Stewart. Hashtag March for What Matters. On Thursday, this Thursday at 3:31 in the afternoon, there will be a March for What Matters in education funding. It's organized by education leaders. The march is beginning at the convention center downtown, where teachers' convention will be happening, and the march will go from the convention center to the legislature for 4 o'clock. So if you're interested in this event and you don't want to march, you can meet at the legislature at 4 o'clock, and at 4:30 there will be a brief program. The purpose of the march is to encourage the government to have sufficient funding for education in the province, and it will be one of several marches through various cities in the province. The education leaders who have organized the march have invited and encouraged people from sectors other than education to join in. So this is a march that matters. So hashtag March for What Matters. And if you have questions about it or want somebody to go with, please talk to me afterwards, after the service, or be in touch with me, and I would be happy to have you come along. Thank you.
All right, I've got my coconuts on today for our Rail Tones concert, which is happening this afternoon down in our Foot Auditorium. So you saw the colorful poster maybe when you came in the church this morning. It's at 3:30 this afternoon, and it's a family-friendly concert. So everyone is welcome. We're pairing up with Michelle and friends, who are local children's entertainers, and we'll do classics like Skinner Ring and Cat Came Back, Baby Shark. But also, ones you might not know, like boneless chickens cannot cross the road. 3:30, and we'll see you then. $10 ticket at the door.
Good morning, everyone. I just wanted to tell you what's happening at day 5 this Thursday at 7:30. Denise and I will be having tea, serving tea and dainties, and we're hoping for a rich discussion with people about how we can end our physical lives in the most satisfying way possible. This is called the Death Cafe. It's an opportunity for you to discuss with people, what would you like your legacy to be? What would you like your funeral to look like? And other questions in that realm. So we hope to see some of you 7:30 on Thursday. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Joanna. I'm here to announce that we're having a pop-up on the 15th of March, that's after church or something. And it's just everyone's welcome. The theme is going to be St. Patrick's Day, so we're going to have a great bunch. But yeah, just get together, great food and eat. So hope to see you there.
And Jasper, just a reminder that next week after the service, we'll have a fundraiser for food security with a, it'll be a lunch downstairs, so please come out. Thanks.
Lunch? And lunch? And this week there are rainbow pancakes. Great. Next week is the first Sunday of Lent, and we will be entering a spiritual practice with our prayer wall. Last year at Lent, we found that the prayer wall that hangs in the friendship room was a helpful way to bring our prayers and our concerns. And so for you to have in mind that we will begin that again next week for the weeks of Lent. 2 weeks ago, a number of our members and friends brought a sermon called Black History Month, Traditional Concepts of God in Africa. That has now been posted on our website. A number of people were interested in reading it more thoroughly. Joseph Natale has put that together for us. Let's make our offerings. share a little peace, and give a whole lot of love. We see your way before us down from the mountaintop. Away from the silence of the peak. Into the cacophony of the world. Called by the earth, we find ourselves listening for your voice. Harkening back to the words of wisdom of your neighbors, yourself, love your enemies, your come from dust. This is my beloved son. You are the children of God. Holy One, we listen for your voice. We look for your wisdom. We lean into one another and on one another's energies. Drawn together by your grace, living with love in your world. We ask your blessing, Holy God. My darling Kalani, our mothers, Alicia and Deandra, our friends and godparents who will love her always, on us who have the opportunity to come to know her, to guide her, to enjoy her, to love her. We ask your blessing on our neighbors and friends who are at Coyote Lake Lodge today. We pray that they have fun. They become closer to one another. They are moved by your beauty on the sparkling snow, the brilliant sky, the commonality of some songs. We bring our prayers for those who are undergoing treatment. Who are in the hospital. Who are experiencing in between times, neither here nor there, neither decided nor firm, neither past nor future. Bring our prayers for those for whom this is a rough winter, not perhaps a time of shining awe, but a time of shining tears. We bring our prayers for ourselves, our families, near and far, our friends, our neighbors, our city, beauty of the earth joins us in awe. And the needs of the world join us in service. Bless us. By the Lord of Sea and Sky, 509, the closest we are to 501. Comes from God.